In our last video, we covered the anatomical structures associated with the oral vestibule, which remember consist of the external borders, which is the lips and the cheeks, and the inner borders, which are the teeth and the gums. Now let's wrap up the anatomy of the oral cavity by going through the anatomical structures associated with the oral cavity proper. And to do that, we need to go through the borders of the oral cavity first. First, we have the anterior and lateral border, which are the alveolar process of the gums, as well as the teeth. We already covered them in the last video, since the teeth and the gums are also the internal borders of the oral vestibule. Superiorly, however, you will find the hard palate and the soft palate. The inferior border consists of the floor of the oral cavity, which is made up of three muscles, the mylohyoid anterior belly of the digastricus and the geniohyoid muscle. And you will find the tongue here as well, in the inferior border. Posteriorly, the oral cavity will continue into the pharynx through the oropharyngeal isthmus. So our goal in this video is to go through all the structures associated with the borders here. We already looked at the anterior and the lateral border in our last video, but now let's start with the superior border, which consists of the palate. The palate is kind of a horizontal partition separating the oral cavity from the nasal cavity. The ventral part is formed by the bony hard palate. It's hard because it primarily contains bone. The dorsal part is called soft palate, and it's formed primarily by tendons. The soft palate is used primarily during swallowing, and I'll show you how in a minute, but now let's go through the hard palate first. The anterior part of the hard palate consists of the alveolar processes of the maxilla, and the posterior part is made up of the horizontal plate of the palate bone. Now the hard palate is bone, and just like the rest of the body, all bones are usually covered by the periosteum, as you see here. And externally to the periosteum, you will find the mucus membrane, which contains minor salivary glands called palatine glands. These palatine glands, they continuously produce a minor amount of saliva to keep the inner environment of the mouth wet. Now, when you look at the hard palate, there are some distinct structures you can actually highlight here. First, we have the incisive papilla, which is a small elevation on the mucosa that lies on top of the incisive canal. You can feel it as a very small elevation here in this region. Then in the midline, we can see the palatine raf, which is a ridge running in the midline here. And then there's the transverse palatine folds, which are a transverse mucosal fold on the oral side of the palate. So that's everything for the anatomy of the hard palate. Now let's go through the soft palate. So the soft palate, again, is this posterior flappy part that doesn't contain any bone. In Latin, you will sometimes see the soft palate as being referred to as the velum palatinum, as described as the free part on the backside of the palate. But essentially, when we talk about the velum palatinum, we generally mean the middle part of the soft palate. But the posterior end of the soft palate is free. It's called the uvula. It's the thing dingling around the backside of your mouth here. Now, what makes up the soft palate? First, I want you to imagine that you have a bag. And this bag is made up of mucosal membrane. And within the bag, you will find muscles or muscle tissue. You will also find a lot of fibers that clump together and form a structure called the palatine aponeurosis. And the palatine aponeurosis functions as an attachment point for many of the muscles related with the soft palate. Other things you will find within the bag are vasculature, you know, arteries, veins, nerves, and lymph tissue. All of them go under this category. But you'll also find mucosal glands or palatine glands similar to the hard palate. And this bag that we just imagined resembles the soft palate and all structures associated with it. So why do we have the soft palate and why is it so important? Well, first thing is that it's involved in the swallowing process. So imagine you're about to take a large bite of this hamburger, but you're so hungry, you end up eating the whole thing in one go. And when you're ready to swallow it, there are actually four directions it can go through. One thing is that it can go into the nasal cavity through the nasal part of the pharynx, or it can get pushed back into the mouth, or it can go down through the larynx and the trachea and down to your lungs, or it can go into the esophagus and then down further into the stomach. The esophagus is where we want to push the food, so the actual swallowing process involves cutting off the other three pathways. So the three steps in swallowing involves the tongue blocking the oral cavity, the soft palate blocking the nasal cavity, and the epiglottis going down and blocking the larynx. Now we only have one pathway left, which is through the esophagus. And here to further help you imagine it through an x-ray, this is a person swallowing water. Did you catch that? Here in slow motion, you will see the tongue going up, the soft palate blocking for the nasopharynx, and the epiglottis blocking the larynx. So that's the main function of the soft palate. The other thing you need to know about it is that it serves as an attachment point for 5 different muscles. So let's go through these muscles. And to do that, we're first going to make a vertical cut like this and remove the backside and then look from this perspective. We will see this. So we have the sphenoid bone. We can see the nasal cavity with the septum here in the middle. We can see the tongue. We can see the uvula. And we can see the horizontal plate of the palate bone. Awesome. So let's use this model to go through the 5 muscles attached to the soft palate. The first muscle is the muscle of the uvula, which is this one. It originates from the palate bone, as you see here, and it inserts at the mucosal membrane of the uvula, and its function is to shorten and elevate the uvula. Then we have a muscle called the levator veli palatini, which is this one. This muscle originates from the petrous part of the temporal bone, as well as from the auditory tube, and it inserts at the palatine aponeurosis, and its function is to elevate the soft palate. Notice that the auditory tube is involved, so when you swallow, it's also going to open up the auditory tube to a certain extent and release some pressure off the middle ear. So levator elevates the soft palate, and then we have the tensor veli palatini, which tenses the soft palate. It looks like this, and it originates from the spine of the sphenoid bone, from the medial lamina of the pterygoid bone, as well as the auditory tube, and it inserts at the palatine aponeurosis. Its function is to tense the soft palate, as well as widening the auditory tube to release some pressure off the middle ear. Then there's the palatoglossus muscle, which is this one. This muscle will originate from the palatine aponeurosis, and then insert at the root of the tongue. And its function is to elevate the root of the tongue and depress the soft palate. And by doing so, it narrows the opening of the pharynx to assist the swallowing process. The last muscle is the palatopharyngeus muscle, which is this one. It originates from the palatine aponeurosis, but it inserts at the lateral wall of the pharynx. So its function is to elevate the pharynx and depress the soft palate, which also assists with narrowing the opening of the pharynx to seal off the pharynx from the oral cavity completely. So these 5 are the big guys when it comes to the soft palate. They are the main muscles. But these 2 up here are special, the palatopharyngeal and the palatoglossus muscle. The reason why they're special is because the palatoglossal muscle is going to form an arch as it goes from the soft palate to the tongue, called the palatoglossal arch. And the palatopharyngeal muscle is going to form an arch as it goes from the soft palate to the pharynx, called the palatopharyngeal arch. And between these 2 arches, you will find the palatine tonsil, which help with the local immunity. And here, just to visualize them better, here's a side view of those arches along with the palatine tonsil. Awesome. So that was all for the anatomy of the heart and soft palate. Now let's talk about the inferior border. The inferior border of the oral cavity proper consists of 2 things. First is what we call the floor of the oral cavity, which consists of 3 main muscles that primarily go from the inner surface of the mandible all the way to the hyoid bone. These muscles are the mylohyoid muscle, anterior belly of the digastric muscle, and the geniohyoid muscle. And just to orientate, you will normally find the submandibular gland below them and the sublingual gland above them. So if you lift your tongue up like this, you will find the floor of the oral cavity here. The other important structure when we talk about the inferior border is the tongue. So let's talk about that. One thing I want you to remember about the tongue is that it's not a muscle, it's a muscle organ, meaning it's comprised of several muscles. The other thing that I want you to know about the tongue is that it's composed of 3 main parts. It's made up of the apex, which is the tip of the tongue, a body, and a root. Now let's look at the tongue from this perspective and go through all the structures associated with the tongue. Now, just to orientate, here you see the palatopharyngeal arch containing the palatoglossus muscle, and here you see the palatopharyngeal arch containing the palatopharyngeal muscle. and between them there's the palatine tonsil, and back here is the epiglottis. So again, the tongue consists of three parts. First we have the root of the tongue, then there's the body of the tongue, and then there's the apex of the tongue. Now the tongue has some important landmarks. First, there's a sulcus here in the middle called the median sulcus of the tongue. Then more posteriorly, you will find another groove called the terminal sulcus, which is a V-shaped groove that separates the body of the tongue from the root of the tongue. At the tip of the terminal sulcus, you will find the foramen cecum of the tongue, which is a small depression here in this region. The foramen cecum is a remnant of the thyroglossal duct, which was a canal formed by the descent of the thyroid during development in fetal life. Behind the terminal sulcus is the lingual tonsil, which lies at the root of the tongue. The lingual tonsil is a diffuse lymphoid tissue located in the submucosal connective tissue that forms bumps on the surface of the root of the tongue. And behind the lingual tonsil, there's the right and the left glossoepiglottic fold, or sometimes also referred to as the lateral glossoepiglottic folds. And what this is that there are two mucosal folds that connect the tongue to the epiglottis to hold the epiglottis in place. And in the middle, there's the median epiglottic fold. Between these folds, there are the epiglottic vallicula, which are depressions between the lateral and the medial glossoepiglottic folds. Other things you will find is that if you lift up your tongue, you will find the frenulum of the tongue, which connects the tongue to the floor of the oral cavity. On either side of the frenulum, you will find a pair of fimbriated folds as well. And on the lower border of the tongue, there's a sublingual fold, which has many small openings for the small sublingual ducts coming from the sublingual glands. And then there's the sublingual caruncle. These are two tubercles, as you see here on either side of the frenulum, where the submandibular and the major sublingual gland open into. Awesome. Now let's go through the muscles of the tongue. Now, the muscles of the tongue are divided into the extrinsic muscles and the intrinsic muscles. Extrinsic muscles, or the extraglossal muscles, originate from bones and insert at the tongue. The intraglossal muscles, or intrinsic muscles, they originate and insert within the tongue. Functionally, the extrinsic muscles focus on movement of the tongue, and the intrinsic muscles focusing on changing the shape of the tongue. So let's look at these muscles. The first muscle is called genioglossus muscle, which is this one. It originates from the upper mental spine of the mandible and inserts at the root of the tongue. And its function is to pull the tongue forward and depress the tongue. Then there's the styloglossus muscle. This muscle originates from the styloid process. So imagine for a second that the styloid process is here. So it goes from the styloid process and then insert at the root of the tongue. And its function is to pull the tongue backwards as well as elevating the tongue. Then we have the hyoglossus muscle, this one. This muscle originates from the hyoid bone and then it inserts at the root of the tongue. And the function is to pull the tongue backwards as well as depressing the tongue. The last muscle depend on the source you're studying from. Some sources say there are only three extrinsic muscles of the tongue, so they don't count the palatoglossal muscle as a part of the extrinsic muscles. But some sources count the palatoglossal as a part of the extrinsic muscles. But we will add this one in our list because it's also going to aid in the movement of the tongue. Remember, this muscle is the muscle that originates from the palatine aponeurosis of the soft palate and goes down and inserts at the root of the tongue. And its function is to narrow the opening of the oropharynx by elevating the root of the tongue and depress the soft palate. So these are the four extrinsic muscles of the tongue. Within the tongue itself, you will find the intrinsic muscles. These are the superior and the inferior longitudinal muscles, which run from the apex of the tongue to the root of the tongue. So its function is to shorten the tongue. Then we have the vertical muscles of the tongue, which connect the upper surface to the lower surface, and its function is to flatten the tongue. Then we have the transverse muscles of the tongue, which arise from the median fibrous septum, and they run to the lateral sides of the tongue. And when they contract, they're going to narrow the tongue. And so that was all the muscles of the tongue. Now on the surface of the tongue, we're going to have something called lingual papillae, which contain taste buds to sense taste. And different parts of the tongue senses different taste because you're going to have different taste buds on several locations of the tongue. First, we have the filiform papilla. They give the tongue its roughness because it contains a thick layer of epithelial tissue on top of it. It looks quite rough when you look at it. Next, we have the fungiform papilla, which is a small elevation that carries taste receptor buds. Next, we have the valate papilla. The valate papilla is located near the terminal sulcus, and this also contains taste buds. Then we have the foliate papilla. The foliate papilla also contains taste buds, and it's located on the lateral regions of the tongue. So that was all the inferior borders. Posteriorly to the oral cavity proper is the oropharynx, and between the pharynx and the oral cavity, there's a narrowing called the isthmus of Fautzes, or sometimes referred to as the oropharyngeal isthmus, which is the bordering line between the oral cavity proper and the pharynx. And that, my friends, is the oral cavity proper. If you found this video helpful, please put a like, share, comment, whatever you find convenient to you. The next video is going to be about the pharynx.